Testing, test automation, stuff like that. Since everybody says it, I will say it too. So if you are a smart student and you want to do a PhD, we have money. So come talk to me. So how this talk actually started? So actually, this talk, when I was preparing this presentation, I thought about the presentation I gave at ESOG this year. So actually what happened is that I arrived to the first day of the conference, 9 a.m. I was drinking my coffee. I was like this. And apparently somebody, so one of the first speakers didn't get to the conference, and he said it too late. So Stefan Ducas told me, Guiche, can you prepare a presentation for in half an hour? I said, I can try. So okay, so I did a presentation. I prepared it in half an hour. It was kind of, it was a pretty decent presentation for half an hour. And then I said, okay, I can reuse it. So I finally decided, I actually passed the machete and did a lot of other stuff. So it's not the same presentation. It kind of shares the same spirit, but well, it's something new. So if you saw the one in ESOG, this one is not entirely the same thing. So what, if I have to highlight some of the things that we did in the last 2 years. So we have the ARM64 VM with the ARM64 JIT. It's working on Linux, Mac, Windows too. So I worked on the Surface Pro X myself on that. We have something that is a couple of packages, a new packages to have support for multi-gigabyte images. I will talk about that. I am working right now on ephemerals, and we have been doing a lot of stability fixes and bug fixing, so it is much more robust. So I wanted to start talking first about the ARM64 because it's a thing that we started doing kind of 2 years ago. And actually, so it's ARM64 and a spoonful of tests. So why did we implement the ARM64 backend? So most people here are probably not in the hardware stuff. So what is important is that now we have a lot of machines that have an ARM64 CPU. Oops, I shouldn't have done that. So we have the new Apple M1, the M2, the Raspberry Pis, the new Microsoft Surface tablet thingies, the Pinebooks, so which are cheaper Linux machines. So they have new CPUs, and we wanted a JIT compiler for that. So we started working with Pablo. So I put, for each of the projects and each of the things that we are doing, I put the little faces. They are probably too small for you, so I will just say the names. So that's me and Pablo. And we started working on the JIT backend for the VM. Some of the highlights, so I don't want to bore you with low-level details. So most of the work actually was just work. So yeah, you just need to open this 2,000 pages manual from the ARM processor, check the instructions that you want, check how it is encoded, and then write a lot of bit banging stuff. So you shift, you AND, you OR, so it's actually not complicated work. So you just need to know what you're doing. But the most interesting things that, from a design point of view, that if you are doing something like that, maybe is of interest to you. So we had to change some stuff in the compiler. So in ARM, for example, multiplication overflow, it has to be detected on software, so you need to actually output instructions to do that. And there's no flag that is automatically set when you have an overflow. We had to also work to overcome the limitations on stack pointer alignment. So the machine, this machine has, so the stack pointer needs to always be aligned to 16 bytes. That means that you cannot just push stuff to the stack. To solve that issue, one of the things that we did was to just go the straight way. Instead of redesigning the entire compiler, what we did is to use, so the smalltalk code, the JIT smalltalk code uses an alternative register to manage the stack pointer. So we are not using the stack pointer for the JIT smalltalk code, we are using the X28. It works pretty well. You have to take care of some stuff and be sure that you are doing it well, but that's all. And then we need to manage the alignment when we are jumping back and forth between smalltalk and C code, for example, because the C code actually has to respect the alignment stuff. So as a byproduct, which is actually one of the things that are of more interest to me, is that we built a test infrastructure for the virtual machine and the JIT compiler. The testing infrastructure is built on top of the VM simulator and the machine simulator. So we have a new machine simulator that is pretty cool, that supports a lot of architectures. And one of the, if you eventually you're writing a compiler and you are writing tests for it, so one of my main things to say is that write black box tests. So in the sense that write tests so you depend on observable behavior. So here, for example, you have the smallest test that probably we have in our entire test suite. So it's the simplest one to explain. So this test is compiling the bytecode that pushes the constant zero. Then we run the generated code, and then we check that if we pop something from the stack, we have the actual object zero there. So we are not testing that we are generating the actual instructions that we want, that they are encoded properly. We are not testing that we have one, two, three instructions there. So so that has a couple of advantages. So for example, this test can run on many architectures. We can, with this same test, we can execute it in ARM, 32, 64, Intel, both, also RISC-V now. And also, it's more resistant to changes. Tomorrow we want to encode this bytecode or some other in a different way, and this test will still be valid, so I don't have to rewrite the entire test suite. The second byproduct of this was that we learned a bit how to make the how can we make work together the simulation, the unit testing, and the actual real execution of the virtual machine to test and apply, for example, TDD. Yeah. So one thing that happened, and it was kind of accidental, we spend much more time writing and living in the unit test world, so writing tests that run fast and are super small and cheap to execute. And then once we were happy with the unit test that we had, we went to do just simulations on the virtual machine simulator. You load the image in the simulator. It's a bit slower and it's a bit more granular. So, but when you are simulating something, so the full simulation, that helped us identify new bugs. And once we identify a new bug, we introduce that in our test suite, and then we could restart the cycle. Eventually, when the simulation was kind of give us enough confidence, we went to actually compile the actual VM and run it on real hardware. One of the funny things is that most of the development of the ARM64 was done before actually we had access to the hardware. So we could we actually put it to production a couple of weeks after the first machine arrived. So we already had most of the development done thanks to this. So if you want to retain something about this, so it is super actually cool to have this simulation stuff. You have to be careful because it's not 100% precise. For example, the machine simulators may make some trade-off between performance of the simulation and so if you are running Intel on an ARM machine, that has to actually need some translation in the middle. So there are some trade-off between performance and precision. So for example, the stack pointer alignment issues were not validated by the machine simulator. So actually, we hit it when we were actually running on the real thing. OK. So that is for my first part of the presentation. So I'm going to structure it in the three, four things that I said before. The second thing I wanted to talk about is about large image support. But for that, actually, the thing that you have to understand is that we are very proud to say that everything is an object. Yeah? So numbers, characters, arrays, collections, strings, they are all objects. So that is very cool. We can talk to them. Everything, we can interact with message sends. But yeah, closures are objects too, and classes and methods. And then if you have a big project, it will have a lot of classes and a lot of methods, maybe on the order of the thousands or hundreds of thousands. So everything is on objects. Then it means that we have a lot of objects. Yeah, and that when you are running an image, so a heap or that has many gigabytes, it can make a lot of stress. So it's a stress for us, but it's also a stress for the GC, for everything that makes searches on the system. So when you do code completion, if you have more methods, you have to actually you have to deal with that. You have to deal when you're searching for a class, you have to deal that you have maybe hundreds or thousands of more classes. So you are going to also start stress the startup of the VM because now you have to load more memory in order to, before actually starting to execute. So thanks to Liveware that promoted this work, Pablo and Stefan Mabley, they worked on a package that is available. It's MIT licensed, that is called Large Images. You can check it. It has actually, it's a collection of several packages and tools to deal with these kind of problems. Again, I am doing highlight stuff. So some of the highlights is that everything that is, so we have many improvements on what is searches. So we are using generators to do to limit the amount of objects that we're iterating before actually giving you some result. So we use generator for code completion, for searches, spotter. We also mix generators with trees, so a tree with T-R-I-E, so with caches and stuff like that. We also have a nice Smalltalk API to configure to do fine tuning of the GC, of the garbage collector, that helps us to configure the size of the den where the objects are going to be allocated, how often the GC is going to run, how big are the new chunks of memory that are going to be allocated, how often are you going to give back memory to the operating system and stuff like that. So all these tools are available. You can check them out. Give us some feedback. So, and we are now, besides this, we're working on something new that is working on semi-permanent heap segments. So the idea is that when you run the full GC, if your image is a couple of gigabytes and your memory, so and you have a standard machine, so we are running on commodity software, maybe it can take a couple of seconds to run the GC if you just have a mark and sweep or a mark and compact algorithm. So, but that happens actually because the full GC has to iterate everything that is there. And maybe we are tracking a lot of objects, but actually we are just collecting a really few of them. Yeah. So one of the ideas that we are exploring right now is to split the heap, so we are kind of adding a new generation with semi-permanent objects. Yeah. So the idea is that we are going to segregate. We are actually, this is already under construction. We are now in the testing phase. So we are going to segregate objects between red and blue, unitarios y federales. So good and bad, I don't know, you choose. So you have the old objects that, and you have the semi-permanent that actually they are going to stay there for a long time, like classes, methods, and method dictionaries, everything that actually has a life cycle that tends to remain almost forever, so they are going to be there. Now the thing we have to, when you have this kind of segregation, you have to deal with that also, because for example, when you are collecting the old space, now you have to iterate much less objects. That's very good, but you have to consider that they may have incoming references from the permanent space. So the permanent objects may be roots for the old objects. Yeah. So, but not all of them are roots of the old space. Because if we have to iterate the entire permanent space to identify the roots and then collect the old space, then actually we didn't win anything. It will be the same as having a full heap. So we have to, this work is mainly done, I forgot. It's mainly done by Pablo and Noel. So I'm just here putting my face. But OK, so the thing is that, OK, how are we dealing with that? This is kind of a standard garbage collector technique. So we are using a remembered set. So the idea is that you have a set where you are going to store the objects that actually are in the frontier between the permanent and the old space. Yeah. And that set, you have to maintain it. And it is maintained, for example, using a write barrier every time that there is a mutation of an object, so an instance variable is written, you have to check and add stuff into the remember set. And you have to, that remember set is cleaned every time that there is a GC that goes on and checks that that actually doesn't hold anymore. So that is kind of standard. So this is already working. And now we have this old space, we have this permanent space, and we have the remember set. So that is pretty cool. And now the question that actually we're working on right now is, how do you decide which are the objects that are red and which are the objects that you put in the blue? Yeah, because depending on how you select these, you may have different trade-offs. So for example, if you do a bad selection, you might end up with a remember set that is big as the permanent space. And then you didn't win anything. Maybe even you lose in performance. So we're now working on some heuristics to select automatically these objects and doing automatic detection of this stuff. So just to show a bit the potential of this, I'm showing here a really small benchmark that we did a couple of weeks ago. The idea is that if we use, for example, some heuristics that put in the permanent space code-related objects, so methods, so classes, methods, method dictionaries, and so you take the graph there. So every time that you take a collection, you take the inner array too. So if it is a collection that has an array, there are some special things with associations and stuff like that. If we move the entire code of, for example, a Pharo image to the permanent space, so here you see red is the percentage of objects that are in the remembers in the permanent space, and blue is the percentage of objects that are in the old space. We end up with an improvement on GC of almost 2 times. So actually, the GC is cut by half. So this is kind of very promising. So we are working on that. We expect to have this for Pharo 11, at least as part of the package of large image support. If you want to take something for you from this talk, and so if you want to remember the minimal things, so do not give GC performance for granted. So it actually depends on how your application behaves, what is the life cycle of your object. So maybe you want to tune it. So fortunately, we can do it. So check it out. If you don't know how to what could be the best configuration for your system, just drop an email and we can talk. So okay. Third part. So I wanted to talk about ephemerons. I am working on putting ephemerons in Pharo 11 since a couple of months. So there is the paper there. And actually what happened, it was not so good. So actually, so I started to work on ephemerons. You make some trials and then boom, crash dump. So eventually what I said is, okay, actually this happened, and since this happened, I shifted a bit my attention towards how do we make the VM more robust, yeah? And actually, we are going to have ephemerons in Pharo 11, but I'm not going to talk about that. So what I'm going to talk about is about a couple of stories that of what we have been doing to test the VM and to ensure that its stability. So one of the stories I already told you about is the simulation-based testing environment that we published in MPLR in last year. And I wanted to talk today about two other things. I think, yeah, I have time. So one is how are we automatically testing the JIT compiler, and the other one is how we are testing the garbage collector, especially for ephemerons, but other stuff too. So automatic interpreter-guided JIT testing. So what is that? So the question that we had was how, so this, I like to use this picture, I use it a lot. So this is a really rough representation of the VM. So the VM has an interpreter. So our VM has an interpreter. It has a JIT compiler. Most VMs have many kind of execution levels, so more or less optimized. When a hotspot is detected, the application is going to run in the compiler or in a more optimized execution engine. Okay, so the thing is, how can we check that these two things are actually working properly? And one of the problems that we have is that they have kind of duplicated semantics. So they will do the same thing, except that one will just be faster than the other one when it executes. But they are not only doing, so they are actually doing the same thing, and they have different code representations, different execution. They manage the execution completely different. They represent the code in a completely different way. So the compiler will do translations and stuff like that, where the interpreter is just taking stuff from the stack and doing things. So here, what you see is the bytecode that does the addition between two numbers. So on the left, you have the bytecode in the interpreter. On the right, you have the a representation of the intermediate representation of the JIT compiler. So just to summarize what is interesting for you. So actually, we see that both of them will check that receiver an argument. So the two things that are on the stack are integers. So we are going to check that in the interpreter, but that we are going to check that also in the JIT compiler. So in the JIT compiled code. We're going to check that there's no overflow, because if there's an overflow, maybe we want to actually fall back to a larger integer representation. And in case none of these things hold, so we found an object that is not an integer or the overflow, we need to go and do a message send, which is slower, but for the common case, so we are optimizing the common case here. Now, the thing is that imagine writing tests for this and for the entire VM with this kind of duplications. You have tests that are duplicated, that are testing the exact same thing, but actually, since they are completely different, we need to duplicate the entire testing environment. So what we have been doing to help us with this was interpreter-guided automatic JIT compiler. What is this about? So the main idea is that we have the interpreter, we have the compiler. We can generate tests using the interpreter. So I will not go very much in details. If somebody asks, or I can tell you how we do it. We are using concolic execution. But the idea is that we are taking the interpreter and we are generating tests for them. And then once we have those testing scenarios, we are using the same test scenario to automatically run on both the interpreter and the compiler. Yeah, since they are semantically equivalent, or they should be, you can actually run the same test on both, and you can check the output. So you can check that if this thing was pushing an integer, then it should push an integer in here, and it should push an integer in there. And then we compare the results. If you find the difference between these two things, there's probably a bug. Yeah. Now. Why did we do this? So first, so this differential testing, so the idea of comparing two different executions by their different values and checking the differences, something that comes from a long time. But we can do it because the interpreter and the compiler, they share the same semantics. The other thing that is interesting is why can we implement test generation using the interpreter is because the interpreter is kind of an executable semantics of the problem. Yeah. So as we can use the interpreter definition in Smalltalk to generate an interpreter definition in C or in machine code, we can also use it to generate tests or other stuff. So how does this work? Not very in detail. So if we could observe the execution of this program on the left, we can actually identify that there are two different conditions in there. So there are things that happen differently if the integer, the receiver and the argument are not integers. So there we have two execution paths that are completely different. And then we have the overflow check. So that means that if both are integers, but they overflow or they do not overflow, we're going to do two different stuff. So we have at least three execution paths in there. So if we could build a program that observes this execution, we can actually identify that there are three execution paths, and we can use those three execution paths to kind of represent the different test scenarios, because we want to test when it is an integer plus an integer that doesn't overflow, an integer plus an integer that overflows, and the cases when they don't, they are not integers. So we did this, we built it, and we ran it. This generated around 5,000 tests, and actually the funny thing is that we found almost 500 differences between the interpreter and the compiler. We went over all of them. So there were 91 unique causes, because sometimes you hit the same thing, you find the same difference, but there is the same piece of code that introduces the problem. And we organized them in six categories. So not all of them are actually critical things. Some of these differences are not bugs, but some of them are. Yeah. So for example, we found 14 cases of segmentation faults. So, and then you go and fix it. The important thing is to detect them. I have 6 minutes to talk about garbage collection. I will give a really two-slide overview of what we are doing. If you want more details, I think next Wednesday there will be half an hour presentation about that. It is too long to me, but okay. Okay, so we have the Smalltalk workshop paper, and then we have an extended version that we sent to ICST, software testing this year, so we're going to see. So how did we actually approach the garbage collection problem? So the first thing is that we observe that most applications, so when you run this, the test of Pharo in the CI, actually what happens is that, so we allocate, the tests are going to allocate a lot of objects and do a lot of stuff. And the GC is going to run from time to time. There are non-determinisms in there. And from time to time, you will have a crash. So we don't have them very often, but from time to time, we have a crash, and we don't like it, because also it's non-deterministic. So reproducing a non-deterministic bug is actually really, really hard. So one of the things that we saw is that, so we started profiling a bit how allocations happen in a couple of benchmarks. And one of the things that we saw is that applications have kind of always the same allocation patterns. So they always allocate small objects, a lot of small objects. And when they allocate large objects, so like here, for example, you can see the byte arrays. So here, it's not readable, probably, for the people that is in the back. But here, each column is a kind of object, and the size is the y-axis. So the higher, actually, the bigger the objects. And the bigger the dot, it means the size of the dot is the number of objects. Yeah. So we see that, actually, the allocations, for example, of big objects are really sparse. So that means that maybe we have a lot of allocations of byte arrays that have 1,000 bytes, some that have 1,500 bytes, but nothing actually is exercising 1,255. So the question is, maybe these allocation patterns do not really hit interesting things for the garbage collector in a consistent way. Also, the thing is that once you have a bug in the garbage collection, you are actually seeing the symptom. Usually, you see a memory corruption. So when you go and check the memory corruption, maybe the application went over many states, and many side effects happen in the middle. So the cause is really far away from that. So we have these two problems. And the question is, OK, how can we deal with these kind of issues? And so we come up with a real, really simple idea. So most of the work that actually does test virtual machines automatically, what they do is generate programs. So it's like here, if we approach this by generating smalltalk code and running it. So instead of that, we said, no, let's directly manipulate the garbage collector and the allocator. Yeah? Like that, we can have more control and determinism. So we know exactly, I want to allocate this object in the new space, and I want to allocate this object in the old space. So like that, if you run an application that makes new, actually that is determined automatically by the system, and you don't have control on how that happens. So what we are doing is to generate, so we have fuzzers, so the idea is to generate automatic test cases, and those test cases are expressed in terms of events. So we have different kind of events, like allocations, mutations, garbage collections events. And we generate lists of garbage collection events. And then we give them to the virtual machine. We run them. And we see if it crashes. Yeah. When you find a crash, you can reduce, actually, the set of events by automatic reduction algorithms that will tell you which events are actually, they don't play any role in the crash or in the bug. And you can also guide what are the kind of events that you are going to construct. Yeah. So, for example, if you want to test ephemerons, you can change the probability to allocate an ephemeron against the probability of having a garbage collector. So maybe you can want to have more frequent allocations of ephemerons than GCs, or I don't know. You can play with those kind of parameters. So we run a couple of experiments. So we first build a completely random fuzzer that just throws stuff at random to the GC. We wrote some other three, one that actually is targeting ephemerons allocations, another one that is targeting corner allocations, so strange allocations, objects that are 255, 256 instance variables, because those are special cases for the GC. Or compaction, so what happens if you have large objects that actually force the collection and compaction of the memory more often. So we found, actually, this number is old because while I was here, somebody sent an email and said, OK, I found another one. So we have at least found 6 bugs. So this work is, we did it with Pablo Jean Privat, that was a professor that was visiting from Canada, and Noel. So one of the funny things was here, you can see, I didn't explain, sorry. The percentage of, so we run it many, many times, and this is the percentage of fuzzings that found a natural bug. So our kernel allocations and ephemeral fuzzers, actually, every time they found a bug. So that those were really simple bugs, but actually you have to think about them, how to find them. So the compaction, actually, 23% of the times we hit a bug, at least with this experience that we have. See, if you want us to keep something for you, so you can use pseudo-randomized testing to test applications. They can be for simpler or complex domains, so you can test the VM using this kind of stuff, but you can also test some other stuff. Doesn't need to be hard. The garbage collection testing actually is not difficult to set up, or a similar thing for another kind of application. We have now the concolic and a random fuzzers that maybe we can extract and reuse in other contexts. So if you're interested in that kind of automated testing, just come to me. I don't have time, so I prepared a potpourri. So we have RISC-V, Nico talked about CMD. We have a lot of debugging tools. We are working on a new compiler. We were working on simplifying the code base of the interpreter and identifying how to localize variables in the interpreter automatically to simplify the code base. We were also checking how the code cache, so the cache where the machine code is stored, how it behaves. So here we see, for example, that loading moves, which is a kind of a big application, we have a lot of thrashing. And then we analyze also how actually increasing those parameters affects the performance of applications. So we are doing a lot of crazy stuff and fun stuff. So that's all I have to say. I was kind of in time. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
I don't know.
One question.
Mariano.
Yeah.
Yes.
One question related to the permanent
space on HEC.
Yes.
Obviously, you still need to garbage collect that area because
semi-permanent.
Semi-permanent would be a better name.
Yeah.
So my question is, how does the VM decide when to run just the old space or when to decide to also run the permanent? It's under certain condition,
if
memory threshold.
Ask Pablo, he will tell you that right now what we are envisaging is to use a manual approach. So some other things so this permanent space, if for example you put the Pharo code in there, so the kernel stuff, you can share it between different images and stuff like that. So maybe you want to really have control on that. So yeah, that is what Pablo is trying to do right now.
Okay.
But manually, so
okay.
Programmatically.
Thank you very much. I think that's time for a break.
Yes.
Thank you, Guillermo.